I invite you to take a moment, to sit straight, close your eyes, breathe deeply, pull your shoulders back. Try not to frown.
You talking to me?
Take this moment just to acknowledge God is here with you. God loves that you are present with him. Try to put aside the things that are distracting you from God's presence. We say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Dear friends in Christ, as we prepare to worship Almighty God, let us with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, confident that we may obtain forgiveness by his infinite goodness and mercy.
Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed,
by what we have done and by what we have left undone.
We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves.
We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent.
For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ,
have mercy on us and forgive us,
that we may be light in your will and walk in your ways,
to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Our opening psalm is, Come Ye Thankful People.
Thank you.
Lord, open our lips.
And our mouth shall proclaim your praise.
God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit,
as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Amen.
Alleluia.
The Lord is our refuge and strength.
O come, and let us worship.
Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to him with songs. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the caverns of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend the knee, and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today we would hearken to his voice. The Lord is our refuge and our strength.
O come, let us worship.
Our first reading.
A reading from the book of Exodus. When the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people gathered around Aaron and said to him, "Come, make gods for us that will go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." Aaron said to them, "Take off the gold rings that are on the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me." So all the people took off the gold rings from their ears and brought them to Aaron. He took the gold from them, formed it in a mold, and cast an image of a calf, and they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it, and Aaron made proclamation and said, "Tomorrow shall be the festival to the Lord." They rose early the next day and offered burnt offerings and brought sacrifices of well-being, and the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to revel. The Lord said to Moses, "Go down at once. Your people whom you have brought up out of the land of Egypt have acted perversely. They have been quick to turn aside from the way that I commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.'" The Lord said to Moses, "I have seen this people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone, so that my wrath may burn hot against them." And I may consume them. And of you, I will make a great nation. But Moses implored the Lord, his God, and said, "O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people whom you have brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, 'It was with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth'? Turn from your fierce wrath, change your mind, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, 'I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have promised, I will give it to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever.' And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he had planned to bring on his people." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. "Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and my crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Eudoia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel to worship, in the work of the gospel together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Once more Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, "The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet." Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, "Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?" And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, bind him hand and foot and throw him into the utter darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen." This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Let's take a moment and consider what God might be saying to us through those readings. Please pray with me. Lord, we ask that we would understand your word to us, and we pray that your word would be buried deep in our hearts and would grow and bear fruit in our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the parables of Jesus assume a certain level of cultural knowledge for them to make sense. They were told to people living in a first century Jewish Middle Eastern context. And so these people had a very specific set of cultural assumptions and expectations about how people interacted and behaved. And for us to understand the parable, sometimes we have to enter into that mindset and expectations and assumptions so that we know kind of what's between the lines of the parable. There are really interesting scholars like Kenneth Bailey, who study Middle Eastern culture and what the culture would have been like back in that day. And they bring really interesting insights into these parables to help us understand, using these kind of cultural insights to help us understand. So let's look at a traditional Middle Eastern wedding invitation, what it would have looked like back then. So there was a social hierarchy, and that social hierarchy mattered. If someone was higher up than you on that social hierarchy, and they invited you to an important event like the wedding of their son, you couldn't refuse to go. It would be a deep offense to refuse to go. It'd be very few circumstances that would exempt you, like maybe the death of a loved one. That might exempt you, but other than that kind of extreme situation, you would not have an excuse to not be there without offending the person. And keep in mind, this is an honor-shame culture as well, so honor and honoring those who are your social superiors, higher up on the hierarchy than you, that's a very important value. And so if a king invited you to the wedding of their son, then that person is kind of the highest on the social hierarchy. And so to refuse to go, to refuse to attend, would be almost unthinkable. So what would happen is the king's servants would go out, they would give the invitation personally to the people who were invited, and then they would, in that moment, hear back from them about them agreeing to the invitation. They would go back, report back to the king, and they would make arrangements for that number of people to be at the banquet. And then the servants, when the banquet is all just about ready, the servants would go out again and would tell those people, okay, everything's set, come to the banquet. So this is the second time they're talking to the servants. Servants went, they said yes, they went back, arrangements are made, the servants go back to those same people and say, okay, everything's ready, come to the banquet. And then the guests would arrive and the banquet would begin. So when we turn to look at our parable, we see that those who are being talked about as being invited, they had already confirmed that they were going to be there. And now they're refusing to come. So this is an extreme insult in Middle Eastern culture at this time. It would be hard for us to understand, because we're not from an honor-shame culture, we wouldn't understand why this is such a problem. In our culture, I think it's Kenneth Bailey uses this example. He says something like this. He says, imagine you're having a dinner party and you invite the guests over, they arrive, and you're having wine in the living room while you're getting the preparations ready for the dinner. So they're enjoying themselves in the living room. And when dinner is finally set, you go and tell them, okay, we're ready, you can come and sit at the dining table. Then they all get up and they leave the house. He says it'd be something like that. So there would be a pretty deep offense and hurt attached to that. So the king, in the parable, responds to this insult with gentleness. He's really humble about it. He's really generous with them about it. So he sends out his servants again and says, tries to encourage them to come. He says, the food is going to be wasted if they don't come. It's ready. Please come. But the guests double down on their rejection and their insult. Some completely ignore the invitation. This is the second now invitation, the third invitation. But others even mistreat and kill the king's servants. This is extreme and unthinkable in terms of the depth of the insult it would be to someone who's a social superior like a king. And so the predictable outcome would be that the king sends his army to destroy those people who would insult him in such a dramatic way. But the king still has a wedding to attend to, even after this destruction. The king still wants to have guests at his son's wedding banquet, and it would be an embarrassment to not have any guests. So he sends his servants out to invite anyone who is willing to come. Invite everybody. Don't be choosy. Invite everybody, the good and the bad. And this is kind of where we want the parable to end. We want it to be all about, there's those mean people, they refuse to come to the party, so God opens the doors and invites everybody in, and they have a big party and everyone's happy. But that's not where the parable ends. There's this one more piece where the king walks through the banquet and he sees someone not properly dressed for the wedding. So there's still an expectation placed on those who are coming to the wedding. Even though there is incredible grace in the invitation, it's invited, everybody is invited regardless of your social standing, but there's still an expectation placed on that person. So that's kind of the cultural background, but what is Jesus saying in this parable to the people of his day? Well, there's some obvious pieces. So God is obviously the king. The arrival of the Messiah is
sometimes talked about as a wedding banquet in for the Jewish people of that time. We talk about this messianic wedding feast or wedding banquet. This messianic figure is the king's son and therefore God's son. And the servants are the prophets. And they're the ones who inform the people of Israel about the coming Messiah. So they, in their writings, in their prophecies, they gave hints that there is a Messiah who is coming. So prepare. This is equivalent to the invitation. Right? You're letting people know that this event is coming. And by people honoring those writings, honoring those prophecies, they are, in a sense, agreeing to participate in that messianic feast. But those people who accepted the invitation now are rejecting, they're refusing to come to this wedding feast now that the Messiah has come. So these rude guests are the leadership of Israel. They are the Sadducees, the Pharisees, they are the scribes, the experts in the law, they are the rulers of Israel. They are the ones who have now rejected the Messiah. They refuse to come to this messianic wedding feast. Even though the prophets earlier let them know, and they honor those prophets as if they were willing to come to this messianic feast, now that it's upon them, they're unwilling to come. And God sends even more prophets. So the last of these is John the Baptist. And he is then even killed by King Herod and rejected by many of the other leaders as well. So here we see the servants being mistreated and killed, as many of the other prophets were as well. John the Baptist is one of those who's mistreated and killed. So the response of the king is the destruction of those leaders, the rejection of those leaders. And this might be referring to the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple in 70 AD by the Roman army. So there was destruction of that temple and the people. The leadership was decimated. Some think that's what's being hinted at here. So since the guests who had been invited so rudely rejected the invitation, God instructs everyone and anyone to be invited. The tax collectors, the prostitutes, the poor, lepers, the uneducated, even Gentiles, the invitation is wide open now. And all are welcome to this messianic banquet feast. This is grace, that you are receiving an invitation that you do not deserve. Everybody's invited. God is not being picky with the invitation. All are invited. But there is this uncomfortable piece at the end. Someone is found not properly dressed for the wedding. And we might make the mistake in thinking that just because the invitation is wide open, that there are no expectations placed on those who are to attend the banquet. And we're wrong to think that. There's a level of expectation for those who are invited. Responding to the generosity means coming ready for the wedding. We shouldn't think that the guest in the parable didn't have appropriate dress for the wedding. It's not like he was too poor to afford a wedding gown or something like that, or he didn't have time to get it. Because when the king confronts him, he even confronts him gently. He says, "Friend, why aren't you dressed properly?" He doesn't have anything to say. So he doesn't have an excuse, which means he did have the ability to dress himself properly, but he chose not to. And maybe it's because the invitation was so wide and open and not choosy that there was a sense that he didn't have to take this seriously. The call to the messianic wedding banquet is a call to transformation. It's a call to repentance. It's a call to take off the old self and put on the new self, to dress appropriate for a citizen of the kingdom of God. There's lots of ways that we could talk about what that symbolizes. It symbolizes a kind of holiness, maybe. Gregory the Great and St. Augustine, they said that this wedding garment is love, the kind of love that is described in 1 Corinthians 13, where Paul says that you can have all these great things, all these great talents, all these great characteristics, but if you don't have love, you don't have anything. So that's what they say it's about. It's about putting on this agape love, this love of God, this self-giving love that marks you as a citizen of the kingdom. That's the new gown that you need to put on if you're going to be a part of this wedding feast. So what does this mean to us? So we looked at the historical situation, we looked at what it might mean for the people in Jesus' day, but now let's look a little bit about what this means to us. And what do I see in this as how does it apply to my life? I see this maybe being a warning that we should be careful about being nonchalant about God's invitation to us. The original guests were nonchalant about following through on their invitations and showing up to the wedding banquet. So they didn't show up. They didn't take the invitation seriously. The guest who was removed from the wedding was nonchalant about showing up properly dressed. So God's invitation, even though it is very widely distributed, is to be taken really seriously. So we might ask ourselves the uncomfortable question. I ask myself this uncomfortable question, thinking about this. How seriously do I take the invitation of God and my response to God? You know, like when we're baptized, we make vows. Do I take those vows seriously? Because in a way, that's me responding to God's invitation to partake in the life of the kingdom. Do we take our call to discipleship seriously? God has called us, and we have responded. Are we responding adequately? Are we responding with seriousness to God's call, to God's invitation? Do we not just show up, but do we seriously consider putting on Christ and the practices that help that become a reality? Are we purposefully working with God to become people filled with God's love? Now, I'm not trying to like crush us with guilt or anything here. And I recognize we can all do better than we are, and so there's always a little hint of guilt when we think about how we could do better. I think this is maybe a question of, are we trying? Right? Are we willing? Are we putting any effort into trying to become the kind of people God wants us to be? What kind of practices are we purposefully putting into our lives to, in a sense, put on that wedding garment? How is our prayer life? How is our study? How is our service to those around us? Does our use of time, does that show that we are serious about being people who are invited to this wedding, about being people of the kingdom? There can be a danger sometimes for us in the church that familiarity can breed contempt. And maybe that's too strong a word, but we can become so familiar with the Bible that we can take its words lightly. We can forget the hands that wrote those words and the danger they were in and what they sacrificed. We can forget about the blood and the sweat and the tears that went into preserving that Bible, those words, so that we can have it. People who risked their lives so that copies would exist so that they can be reproduced so that we can have them. And, you know, we let it sit there with and just gather dust. Or what about that little wafer that gets placed in our hands? It's easy because we're familiar with it to just think this is just bread. Because God in his humility came to us so simply that he wants to give us his life, not in any sort of an extravagant, hard to access way, but in a way that is so simple and accessible as it's a little piece of bread in your hand. And this is God wanting to give his life to you. It's so easy to take that for granted. And maybe that's something we can learn during this pandemic when we've been denied access to our own community, that we are maybe learning not to take some of these things for granted now that we don't have access to them in the same way that we have had access to them in the past. And this is something that we can maybe think about during Thanksgiving. We should maybe consider the things that we take for granted and to take time to be grateful for those things. The theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer spoke about cheap grace in his book, The Cost of Discipleship. He says, cheap grace is coming to the banquet. The way that I would apply this. Cheap grace is coming to the banquet and not thinking that there is anything expected of you. It's like you come in and forgiveness is poured down on you without you needing to repent. Without you needing to confess, forgiveness is just given to you. And you don't even have to worry about trying to change. You don't have to worry about even feeling bad about what you did. You just are forgiven. That's cheap grace. This is his words. He says, cheap grace is the preaching of forgiveness without requiring repentance, communion without confession. Cheap grace is grace without discipleship, grace without the cross, grace without Jesus Christ, living and incarnate. Cheap grace is saying there's nothing expected of you and that God just pours out his blessings on you and you don't even have to respond in any way. You don't even have to put out your hands to receive it, right? It's just forced upon you. Costly grace seems to be the grace that Jesus is offering us. It's the invitation to follow Jesus, and it will cost our action, it will cost our will to participate, to walk behind him, but it's grace because we're following Jesus, and Jesus loves us, and he's generous, and he's merciful, and he wants what's best for us. When we are broken by our own sin, and we feel like we are trapped in a dark room with no doors and windows, that we have reached a brick wall that we cannot pass. Costly grace in that moment, in that darkness, in those tears, opens up forgiveness for us. And that forgiveness leads to transformation. It's not just a band-aid forgiveness that just sort of pretends it'll all go away. It promises transformation. Costly grace is selling everything you have so that you can buy a field where you know that there is a hidden treasure. It requires selling everything to get that, but it's better than what you were selling. Costly grace recognizes that God owes us nothing and that anything God offers us is an undeserved gift. And we pursue that gift with all of our strength to be able to receive it. God's invitation is wide. God wants as many people as possible at the Messianic wedding banquet. The invitation is generous and gracious, but that doesn't mean there are no expectations placed on those who have agreed to attend. We are to put aside our old grubby clothes and instead put on the clothes of the kingdom. We are to put aside the old self and put on the new self. We might grumble about an expectation being placed on us, but a willingness to be transformed is really just another way of saying that we actually want to be a part of this banquet. We want to be a part of this kingdom. May God have mercy on us and help us in that. Amen.
I invite you to stand as we recite our creed. Let us confess our faith as we say,
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Our offering hymn is For the Fruit of All Creation.
Sessions today, I just want to share a personal observation. The last 6 months have been perplexing, confusing, unsettling. They have forced me to focus on really what is important to me and to count the true, real blessings bestowed on me by God's grace. So I ask you, as we gather today on the Feast of Thanksgiving, I invite you to join me in giving thanks to God for his grace and mercy. For our intercessions today, the supplication will be, Lord and giver of all. The response, we thank you for your blessings, grace, and mercy. We thank you for your blessings, grace, and mercy. Let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for your worldwide church, for the solid rock it has provided us during these times of turmoil, uncertainty, and shifting sands. We thank you for the courage, strength, commitment, and guidance you have given its leaders
as they strive to lead your children through their journey as disciples of Christ. We give you thanks for the technology that has opened up new channels for worshiping, and for the incredible minds and talent that make this possible. Today we raise up the church and leaders in Uganda, in our companion diocese of the Windward Islands, and in our diocese of Calgary. In the Red Deer area, we raise up the Riverside Baptist Church. In our parish of St. Leonard's, we give utmost thanks for the prayerful guidance provided by our shepherd, Reverend Chris, and all who assist him in guiding our church family. Lord and giver of all, we thank you for your blessings, grace, and mercy. God of knowledge, wisdom, and guidance, we give you thanks for the commitment and dedication of all teachers in our schools as they strive to guide our young people, our future, along the path of knowledge, justice, and truth. Please keep these precious resources safe and healthy at all times, and especially now. Lord and giver of all, we thank you for your blessings, grace, and mercy. Gracious and merciful God, we thank you for all the daily blessings you bestow on us, many of which we may sometimes take for granted. For a city, province, and country that allows us freedom of speech, political democracy, and freedom of worship. For the warmth and shelter and space of our homes. For an abundance of food and resources to take care of our health. For all who labor on the front lines to keep us healthy, fed, and safe. For the love of our families. For the love and support of our church community, remembering today families of Rhonda Holt, Murray and Elsie Howard, and Tom and Janet Hunter. Merciful God, help us never to forget brothers and sisters everywhere who are bereft of these gifts and necessities of life, trapped in hunger, poverty, and loneliness, threatened by political upheaval, religious terrorism, and natural and man-made disasters. We beseech you to aid them in rebuilding their lives. Show us ways to share your bounty. We are all one in the body of the Lord. Lord and giver of all, we thank you for your blessings, mercy, and grace. God of mercy and grace, whose blessed Son Jesus Christ went about healing all manner of sickness and disease among the people. We thank you for all the doctors, nurses, specialists, and all who have made it their passion to help us heal our bodies and minds. We know that their gifts of healing come from you, Lord. Through your grace and mercy, please help them to bring relief to our brothers and sisters going through difficult times, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. For those in hospital, Ada and Dawn. For our parishioners, Jim, Karen and Colin, Elaine, Susan, Norma, Vigo and Joan, Grace, Murray, Jean, Marion. We also thank you for healing that you provide in others known to us, whose burdens we carry on our hearts. Lena, Velvet, Andrew, Des, Naya, and Dom. Denise, McKenna, Carol, Junior, Will and Megan, Ben, Addison, Jody, Pat, Carly, Sandra, Kerry, Gerald, Logan and Leah, Jordan and George, and any who you might have in your hearts. Lord and giver of all. We thank you for your blessings, mercy, and grace. Eternal Father, we thank you for the comfort that our trust in you brings at times of grief and sorrow in loss of loved ones and those pending the loss of loved ones. As each of us continues that journey of grief, we thank you for the blessed assurance that our loved ones are now with you and will be with you, free from pain and suffering and sadness. We remember the family of Elaine Joel. I'd also like to bring forward Jan Underwood and her family in the loss of a husband, father, and grandfather, Peter Underwood. Lord and giver of all, we thank you for your blessings, mercy, and grace. In closing, in that beautiful hymn, Now Thank We All Our God, verse 2 declares, O may this bounteous God through all our life be near us, with ever joyful heart and blessed peace to cheer us, and nourish us with grace, and guide us when perplexed, and free us from all ills in this world and the next. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Please pray with me. Creator of the fruitful earth, you made us stewards of all things. Give us grateful hearts for all your goodness and steadfast wills to use your bounty well, that the whole human family today and in generations to come may with us give thanks for the riches of your creation. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord.
Amen.
And our general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life. But above all, for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Now our final hymn, Now Thank We All Our God.
Thank you.
Bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore.
Amen.
And the peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you all.
Amen.
Thank you.